processors and declaring variables volatile. Okay, what is the need of preprocessors and when and how we can declare the variables volatile. Okay. Before that, let me just talk about the program. Okay, in this program, in the last class we discussed a program in which we wrote codes to blink an LED. Okay, in that we used the addresses of the registers. Okay, I believe you now you know how to decode the address of any particular register. For that you have to have the knowledge of the base address, then the offset, add them, and then you can enter a data to that particular address. This particular code is your typecasting. That means you are forcibly saying this particular address is declared as an unsigned integer, and here this star is telling that this whole number or this particular whole double brackets are okay pointers. So you are pointing to an address and entering a data to an address by using typecasting. Okay, this approach is very tiresome, because in that case what you need to do is go check the data sheet again and again and find the address, write the address, and until unless you put the comment, it will be very difficult for any other user to decode your code. Because this code or this particular program, if I share with anyone, then he will also have to go to the data sheet, download the data sheet, and he will have to search what this address basically is. So it is a very tiresome and cumbersome job. So how we can slowly and slowly we will try to make this particular approach a bit more easier, so that the designer can focus more on the designing part or the coding part, and then the rest of the users, if they take your code, they can easily decode what their code is doing. Okay, so this is definitely a long process and it takes very much time to get to the code. So today we are going to start with preprocessors and volatile, and we will see how these particular two things will help us to simplify our code. And I'm not saying that this will simplify your code in all aspects, but of course it will help you to easily understand the codes. Okay, in C, okay, we have preprocessors. They are used to make the program to develop easily. It will also helps to understand the program in a simple way by easily reading the code. So it makes you can easily read the code by using preprocessors. Of course, you can, if you can understand and read the code, then definitely you can easily modify the code also. And then, like I said, you can port the same code from one computer to another computer in a much easier fashion. Or one computer to another computer, or you can say one microcontroller to another microcontroller system in a much easier way. Okay, for that we will use preprocessor. So in short, we can say that preprocessors are used to literally customize the C language. Customize means you can write it in your own way. You can define the things and you can declare it in your own ways. Okay. Remember, preprocessors actually analyze these statements before analysis of the C program itself. So any compiler, before compiling the C program, he will first analyze the preprocessor and he will keep track of the preprocessors. Like in the previous examples, you might have observed that when we declare a variable or when we initialize a variable, the computer or the microcontroller do not take time to do that part. Okay, similarly, preprocessors also are analyzed before the program or the C program is getting analyzed. Preprocessors are identified by the presence of this particular symbol. You might have used this symbol many a times when you are dealing with C programming or C++ programming or any other language, hash. Okay, so hash, this particular symbol signifies that you are using a preprocessor. And remember, first non-space character of the line. So if you are using hash, okay, to define something, then you should avoid putting spaces in the name of the particular preprocessor. So avoid spaces. So first non-space, remember this thing is important. So these are small things, but generally people make mistakes in this particular thing. So preprocessors will help you to easily develop your code, read the code, modify the code, shift the code from one microcontroller to another microcontroller. And remember, hash is used to symbolize that you are going to use a preprocessor after it. Okay. Now, for example, this preprocessor. For that, first we are going to use define, hash define statement. Okay. So hash define statement, with that define, you can define yes is equal to 1. Okay, so in place of 1, you can print yes from here onwards. So once you have defined, okay, yes equal to 1, then you can use yes. So this defines name yes and makes it equivalent to 1. So in this way, you can symbolize things which will make more sense. For example, let us go a bit more deeper and try to understand these things. Rather than using 1 again and again, you can use yes, yes, yes. Okay, let us see here. Hash define and. So many of you might be using if. Okay, if value, okay, is less than 5 and. Okay, value 1 is less than 5 and value 1 is greater than 3 or greater than 1. Okay, then you can pass some statement, do this particular task, right? So you might have used this kind of codes where you use symbol and. And many a times you think that, okay, this particular symbol is bit sometimes confusing, and I confuse between this and single and double and. Okay, so rather, if this kind of things are there in your programming, okay, you are facing some issues with the symbols or something, you can literally name them like and. Okay, so and now onwards will be in place of and, you can just write and. Directly. Okay, so you can replace the code wherever there is an and symbol, you can replace it with and. Similarly, rather than using this symbol, most of the time, you know, students are struggling, they struggle to find where this particular key is in the keyboard. So you can, rather than, you know, searching again and again and again in the keyboard, you can just define it. That if I am going to use OR, I can declare OR and then you tell the symbol. So in place of this symbol, you can use OR. Like if value 1 is less than 5, or in place of this, you can put OR, which makes much, much easier for a person to value 2 is greater than 6. Okay. So in this way, you can use either this symbol or this OR. So it actually helps you to simplify the way you look into the code. Okay. So you can simply literally change all the symbols or all the arguments or even the operators in this way. And it will make more sense to read the code easily. For example, writing this line, x asterisk x, that means x into x. Rather than using this, you can just write square, of x. So rather than writing x into x again and again, you can just write square x. So wherever you use square x, it will define or it will mean that you are talking about this x into x. So simply you can simplify the code in many ways, different ways. You can simplify the code to write in according to your taste also. Let us now keep an eye on the previous code and let us check how we can use this preprocessor to simplify our life in the code that we have used or developed in the previous class. Before that, let me just show you some of the example codes. In C, okay, how can you use preprocessors in C? It's taking time, I think. Okay. So here, you can see, I believe you can see the code block now, right?
Yes, yeah. Sir.
So now in place of 3.14592654, you can just write pi. So in place of writing this number, you can just introduce pi in the code wherever you need that part. For example, double area, double R, R is, this particular is your argument, R is your argument, data type double. Okay, return, this code will return pi into R, that is area. That is pi into R square, pi R square, or area of a circle. Similarly, to find the circumference, you can just write this. And to find the volume, you can write like this. And then in the main, for example, these are all functions defined, separate functions are defined. Even though they are defined before the main, remember when you execute or compile a C program, the first compilation starts from the main, remember. So the main will start the compilation and inside that you have called double area. So now the area, this is a function. And now the compiler will check where this area is actually defined in the program. So from here, the program will jump to this location. If you recall the way you wrote assembly codes in 8085, you just put labels there. You can just correlate the same concept here. It is just a kind of label. From here, the program jumps to this location. Otherwise, if you have not declared any function area, the program will throw an error. Okay. So now you have defined a label kind of stuff. And inside the label, you are saying that, okay, you will be using this variable R. So whatever be the variable R, you can just put the value of R and it will give you the area of the circle, pi r square. You just have to define the value of r. Similarly, you can call the function circumference and the function volume. Remember, only thing that you have to do is to provide the value of r. Okay. So similarly, here you can say printf double quotes. Double quotes means whatever we want to write, we can put it there. So radius equal to 1:%.f. If you remember, I told you what are the role of this percentage and f or I or d. So similarly, there are many other o, percentage o and all. Percentage f is used to define that the variable will be floating type. Okay. And then in the area, you are passing the value of r because area needs an argument. You see here area, the function area needs an argument, which is double r. Double is the data type and the name of the variable is r. So you just have to provide that variable here. So area, then you put the value of the r. The compiler will compile that and then circumference for r equal to 1, volume for r equal to 1.0. You can see here that this code is automatically, when I am bringing the pointer here, okay, the program actually tells that, okay, this is double volume, double r. It is actually pointing to a function which is of type double and the variable in the argument is also of the type double. Okay, and the name of the variable is r. You can see from here, it is automatically correlating everything. From here you can learn this thing. And again, if you want to change the radius, just change the radius to another value, and circumference and everything will be calculated depending on the values you have entered into the argument. Okay, just let us check. Okay, just let me check if I can. Okay, see, radius equal to this, and corresponding to that you get the value of, for example, first you are getting the area of the circle, circumference of the circle, and then you are getting the volume of the circle, a sphere. Okay, and then if pi r cube, okay, let me check. So in this way you can just say that, okay, for a radius 4.98, this is the area, circumference, and the volume. Okay, so this is how you can execute or simplify your life, because here you see we have defined pi equal to this, rather than writing everywhere the value of pi, you can just eradicate that line. Okay, now let us take the same concept of C and see how can we simplify our code. Okay, so in the preprocessor, okay, here you can see we are having a complex line. This particular line is a bit complex because that was the only part which was difficult to understand. Star, then bracket, then type casting, then variable. Okay, so it is a bit complicated, long so-called version. So what you can do is define. So this is what this particular thing is. This particular thing is nothing but the register RCGC, right? So rather than looking into the address in the hexadecimal format, what we can say, we can define RCGC GPIO. Okay, and then you define whatever you want to use. Just if you recall, pi and then the value. Simple. So similarly, you are defining the name of the register and what represents that particular value. Done. So this way, from here onwards, you can just simply use RCGC GPIO instead of writing this whole complex line. And you can say, okay, RCGC GPIO is equal to 0x20u. So in place of the complicated line, you can replace particular line by simply writing RCGC GPIO. Clear? So this helps to simplify the code. Wait a second. This helps to simplify the code. So let us look into the code. Now, here you see, I believe you can see, is there any issue? If let me know. Okay, can I know? Okay, so here what we are doing, we are defining RCGC GPIO, and this is our declaration that from here onwards, rather than writing this whole complex line, we can just write RCGC GPIO. Similarly, or you can write it like this also, GPIO base address of GPIO is 4002 5000 U. Okay, so to get the final address, you know that every time what we are doing, finding the base address, then adding the offset, finding the base address, writing the adding with the offset. So we know that we are going to work with the GPIO F, port F. So everything related to port F will be used in the program. So port F, port F's data direction register, port F's data register, port F's direction digital enable register. So we have to go to three different registers of port F only: direction, digital enable, and data. So what we can do, we can just simplify this particular line like this: define GPIO dir. Okay, this particular line, now from here onwards you can see this is your let me zoom in a bit more. Okay, this part with the gray part is your type casting. This part is your, this bracket is your pointer. Okay, up to this, and you are declaring GPIO dir will represent, remember, including the bracket, everything, whatever you write after define GP, this is the variable that will be using the preprocessor, you can say, and after that whatever comes okay, will be your complete preprocessor's value. So including the last two brackets also. So this will be your DIR register, direction register, digital enable register, and data register. Done. Okay, clear. And instead of writing, so for example, you see, now we have replaced this particular line by simply RCGCGPIO equal to 0x20. Similarly, you replace the DIR register, GPIO DIR register, with just simply writing GPIO DIR equal to 0EU. And last but not the least, you told that this is your digital enable register in which you entered 0E. Okay, 0E. Clear. So in this way, you just simplified your program, and the data you entered the value of the variable, whichever for the LED red, because 02 will make the LED red glow, 04 will make the green glow, and so on. You can then, you have the counter to, for the delay, which is same. Okay, this is the same which was used in the previous example, but here instead of writing the whole lengthy complex address and everything, you can simply write GPIO data is equal to 0x02u. So first of all, you have to understand that before we were using this, this is the actual or the so-called raw way to approach to a register. Find the address of the register, add the base address with the offset, and then enter some value into that. That is your gray line right now. We simplified the same line with the use of preprocessor. And now this line makes more sense compared to the line above, because now we know that we are entering something into the data register. Okay, similarly, something into the digital enable register. We are entering some value in the DIR, that means direction register, input or output. So now it makes more sense rather than reading this code. Of course, this code, the above code, will be only decoded, only the electronics engineers who have the knowledge of registers and all will be able to decode this particular first line. Whereas this particular line can be a bit more easily understood by, can be used by computer science programmers or any other programmers who have some basic knowledge of programming. Okay. Clear? Anyone having any difficulty to understand how the preprocessor is used in this program? Do parallelly write these things in your project also. So IAR code, now let us see the IAR code. See how beautiful it looks like now. So you defined the preprocessor. You defined GPIO base is equal to 4000 to 5000U, and then you have used the base, and then you provided the offset. It makes much more, this makes much easy to understand the same thing. And you are naming them as direction register, digital enable register, digital data register. Done. And then you entered the value of 20 to make the red LED on to the RCGCGPIO to first clock gating, port F, clock gating is done. Then direction of port E, port F is defined that it is output port. Then you digitally enabled that particular port, that means for digital read or write purpose. And then you entered the value to write actual value in the port F, which is 02, to make the red LED glow. If you make it 04, it will make green LED, blue LED glow. If you make it 08, it will make the green LED glow. And then you called a delay by using a while function. Then again, you change the data to 00, that means making the output port 0. So in one time, you are making it high. Second time you are making it low. Clear? And then again a delay. So this will keep on repeating until unless you stop reset the microcontroller. So this is how you can simply modify the code, and it now the reading the code is much more easier. At the same time, it is more sensible, okay, rather than writing star bracket bracket and signed in. But okay, so this is how you simplify the code. Anyone having any difficulty to understand how the preprocessor is used and how it is simplifying the programming?
Sir, in this method also we have to first look at the data sheet and get all the address and then define the
one time.
But remember, here you are. Sir, isn't there some library for a particular?
Definitely. Wait a second. Yeah. I am teaching you how to write a library also. Understood? Why you are forgetting that part? You are actually asking me the thing how to get there, how to use a third party library is a different thing. First of all, I am teaching you how to generate a library.
Yes,
tomorrow,
sir.
If you don't have a library, then being an embedded engineer, you cannot use that hardware in that case. So, of course, it tastes bad. This particular thing is not tasty. It is not simple as C, C++ program. But of course, embedded engineer should know that what he is doing basically. What that library is, or even if tomorrow you get a library in your hand, how to read that library. Because most of the time you will see students, then they can write a, they can take a library and they can write some functions which are defined in the library. But if tomorrow someone asks you, nay, change the function, then no one has the knowledge how to do that. Why? Because they feel this part is very difficult. So of course this part is difficult. These are for embedded engineers. So of course we will come to that part. This course is still pending, so we have enough time to complete this course. But this is how you actually should proceed to write a program. Okay, I can go and easily tell you this is the library, take this function, write this thing. Arduino is doing the same thing. Yeah, so we are avoiding that thing. We are going to learn how to use that particular thing. Okay, so this is how you develop a library and then you can use the function. So how many of you have the hardware? Please try to run this code and check if you are able to make the red LED glow. Okay. Now, anyone having any other difficulty or doubt? Anyone having any difficulty or doubt? No. Okay. Then we can proceed. Now coming to the header file. Okay. Now to avoid defining all the macros, because again, like the student asked, there are now even after that, the programming seems to be a bit difficult part. Okay. Because you are actually interacting directly with the hardware. In place of that, of course, all the microcontroller vendors, most of the microcontroller vendors, okay, microcontroller vendors, they provide you the header files. Microcontroller vendors will provide you header files, which will contain the list of all macros for each and every register of the microcontroller. Of course, they know that users don't like to work in the way we discussed the example in the last code. Okay. So the microcontroller companies, or not only microcontroller companies, even those companies which develop sensors or any other peripheral, okay, which can be programmable. So every company which is producing programmable devices, they provide you the header files. And inside that header file, they actually define these macros. And when we open those header files, we will be able to understand those header files more easily if we understand the concept that we learned in the last two or three lectures. Otherwise, it will be very, very difficult for any other engineer to decode that header file. Decoding header file is not an easy part. It is for embedded engineers. Now, Then we can learn how to add the header files and header file in the project. We will learn that. And of course, pointer casting or pointing to some particular variables and all with volatile qualifier. Why we use volatile qualifier? This is a big question, because you might have used volatile in your C program also many a times. Even mostly when you are using interrupts, you tell the compiler or you tell the software that this particular pin is volatile. Or in English, normal English, what volatile means? Volatile means something which is very delicate and which can change its behavior at any time. Some people are volatile, or we can say they are very sensitive. Petroleum is volatile. Even a small spark can ignite the petrol and it can burn it. So those are volatile kind of things which are very reactive. Okay, so it can change any time. So those kind of pins are generally, or those kind of variables are defined volatile. That means even if the program is not changing them, even if the program is not changing them, sometimes they may change their behaviors automatically. Like the interrupt pins. In the interrupt pin, the program never changes the value of interrupt line. It is the user or the external sensor which actually changes the value of the pin. So we have to define that pin as a volatile, because the program is not going to change it. The external factor will change it. Or we can say like this, volatile qualifiers are declared that those values which in which the variable might change spontaneously, even if the program might not change it. This is very important thing. So in C, we can declare a variable volatile if we know that in future, this variable may change its value even though the program is not changing it. It may be changed due to external factors which are not inside that program directly. Okay. So in such cases, we should declare those variables volatile. Clear? So declare those variables which may change due to external factors rather than the program itself. Okay, you can declare them volatile. Okay, let me just go through the pointer. Okay, remember this red part. In 32-bit microcontrollers, 32-bit microcontrollers, when we are saying, remember the Cortex M4 that we are using in TYC board is a 32-bit microcontroller. And of course, almost all the ARM microcontrollers are focused on 32-bit microcontrollers and programmers. Okay, 32-bit mostly. Okay, now they are developing 64-bit, but basically the architecture is 32-bit oriented. Okay, so in 32-bit microcontrollers, data type int and long are generally of the same size. For example, unsigned int and unsigned long both will have the same meaning. So you can declare either a variable as an unsigned int, or you can even declare it as an unsigned long. But preferably, we definitely go for the int, because we know that int always takes the size of the word of the microcontroller. Word means whatever be the is the bit size of the microcontroller. For that means, if the microcontroller is 16-bit, then int will be 16-bit. Okay, if the microcontroller is 32-bit, int will be 32-bit. That means we can write it like this. If microcontroller is 16-bit, okay, then int is also 16-bit. Similarly, if the microcontroller is 32-bit, then the int is also 32-bit, okay, and so on. If the microcontroller is 64-bit, then int is also 64-bit. Clear? Or we can say the word is the size of the microcontroller itself in terms of bits. Clear? Now, a volatile qualifier, like I said in the previous slide, it may change at any time. Okay. It is included in the language, in the program, to prevent compiler from optimizing the code. Now it is a bit confusing. What does that mean? That means the compiler automatically optimizes the code? Yes. If you have not specifically mentioned to the compiler, okay, that don't optimize this code, then what the compiler will do is, the compiler always try to generate a code which is optimized from its own end. Okay, so you might be writing a code in a different keeping something in your mind, but the compiler may actually optimize that code. Giving a simple example, for example, you declared a variable int a equal to 10, okay, and then you declared int b is equal to 6, and in your program, in your main, okay, int main, okay, you declared int c, okay, also, which is not initialized. You wrote that, okay, c is equal to b, that's all. Now what happened? The value inside b, or b's value 6, will be transferred to or copied to c also. So you remember, always read the code from the right hand side towards the left hand side. So the value of b will be transferred to c. This is the meaning of this particular code. Now in this particular program, a is not used, right? So when you try to compile this code, the compiler may actually delete the variable a, because he looks into the code and he finds that a is not utilized anywhere in the program. So it will optimize the code, it will remove the variable a, and or it may also declare it will, declaration is also nullified. So now if you don't want the a to be removed from the code, okay, then in such case use volatile. Okay, that means the variable will not be optimized by the, or the program will not be optimized by the compiler, and it will not remove the variables. Okay, for example, let us take an example. In this, remember, in this example, not using volatile qualifier in front of the counter variable, okay, avoids the compiler to check the loop corresponding to the change in the counter variable. For example, let's go and check what does that mean. We are actually focusing on the counter variable here. In the previous program, right, in the previous program, I will tell you what this header file and how to get this header file and all. Okay, in that we declared a variable counter, right? And if you go to the project options, inside that you will come debugger. Let me check general. This is done compiler. This is optimization. So in the C++ compiler, okay, inside C++ compiler, there is one tab called optimization. Go to that tab, and if you see here, okay, if you see here, there are three or four different levels of optimization which are actually provided by the compiler or the IDE itself. So if you put it none, okay, in such case, what will happen? You can see enabled transformations. Transformations means how the compiler is going to modify your program. Okay, for example, if I make it high, the loop unrolling, that means wherever there are variables which are using loops and changing the variables inside the loop or so, they will just be neglected in the program. They will be totally neglected until and unless you declare them as volatile. If you don't declare them volatile and check two things, once you make this optimization none, in that case, I'm giving you this task. Okay. In that case, when you are making, let me just go to this slide. Okay. Okay. So you have to keep an eye on the code. When first you go to the projects button tab, from there you go to options. Okay, from there you go to C/C++ compiler. Okay, from there you go to optimizations. Okay, inside that you keep an eye that first you make the optimization none, and in the second case make the optimization maximum or high. Okay, there is an option high in that. Okay, and when you compile the project and then when you go for the debugging, in the debugging, during debugging, okay, remember, during debugging, check the disassembly. Sorry, wait a second. Disassembly window. Disassembly window. Okay. And inside the disassembly window, check the while loop. What is the disassembly code generated for the while loop? Check that thing. Okay. Same you check when you use the optimization high. Okay. During the debugging, check the same thing. Check the disassembly window and check what is the code generated for while loop. Okay. You will find that inside the while loop or the counter variable, okay, in the disassembly window, the counter variable, okay, counter variable will be missing if you use high optimization. Okay, you might observe that missing counter variable, because the IDE has optimized the code and counter variable is not doing any important task in the program. So it is just wastage of memory and just changing the value becoming zero. So it will optimize and it will neglect that part. So please go and check this thing and do let us discuss it in the next class. Okay. So this is important. So volatile should be used in all such way, in such cases where the optimization may take place and it may neglect or nullify the effect of some variables which are sometimes very important for any program. For example, if we don't declare them volatile here, okay, then what will happen? The counter variable will be optimized and you will not see any effect of optimization in the hardware also. So please do keep these things mind. Okay, when we should use optimization and when we should not use optimization. Secondly, when we should use volatile variable and when you should not use the volatile variable. Anyway, so please use volatile variable wherever you have the gut feeling that this variable may change, even though the program might not be changing it, like in case of interrupts or any other variable which may get affected from external conditional changes which is not in the program. First thing, the use the volatile in such conditions. Second, when you are using highly optimized code, then in such cases, remember the IDE or the compiler may optimize or nullify the effect of those variables which are not used as a volatile. Okay, keep these things in mind.
Sir, wouldn't a simple print statement do the same job for us? For example, if there is a variable like counter which is not doing a great job in the code, but if we are printing it, then the compiler
might not delete it,
cannot remove it.
Yes. Because it is being used in the program. Yeah, so because that is affecting the IO, no? So printing is taking place of the for the counter, then it will, might not delete it. So I am telling you these things because we cannot go and check each and every example of the world. But we should be careful when we are using such variables. Okay, if we have this kind of feeling that it may change or this should be there in the program or this variable should not be changed or nullified or the compiler should not interfere with these variables, at least these variables, if we want to give some extra care on those variables, then we should keep it volatile. Okay, clear? And later when you are having a different program in your hand, when you are dealing with more complex programs, keep an eye on these kind of things, whether the optimization is high or low, medium, and then what kind of effects are taking place, because I cannot go and elaborate each and every possible case in the course. Okay, but you should also try to get into those parts if possible, and definitely come and share those ideas or examples which you have seen while going through the course. Okay, now bitwise operands, these are very important, especially when we are becoming an embedded engineer. Bitwise operations are very important. For that, remember we use symbols like AND, OR, okay, XOR, NOT, right shift and left shift operands. So these are bitwise operands. That means these operators work on the bit itself. That means you can change the system bitwise, or you can change the variable's value bitwise. Okay, so I believe you know the meaning of AND or XOR, NOT, right shift and left shift. Sometimes this is one important question. When we use, or in generally when we use XOR, what is the utility of XOR and why it NAND? You see, there is this thing. Why there is no specific symbol for NAND operation or NOR operation, whereas NAND and NOR are considered to be universal gates and so on. But here we see specifically XOR is given more priority than NAND, NOR, or any other complex gate. Why so? What is the advantage of, or why we keep generally XOR, or when we should use XOR in real life? XOR, when we should use XOR?
Mm-hmm. When we are trying to find similarities in bits.
Yeah, similarities in bits. Yeah, similarities in bits or changes that has taken place during any particular operation. So similarity or you can say changes also. So these are the XOR gates are the most common gates to find the error in bits when there is a transmission taking place. So if you are transmitting a sequence of bits, like you tried to send 0101, so you are sending it and it is going through a system, and at the end of the system you are getting 1011, something like that, then using XOR you can find which of these bits are having error. Why and how XOR actually helps to find the bit are having error or not? What is the functionality of XOR?
XOR is when two similar kind of bits like 0 and 1 are XOR.
get 0 as output.
If these two number A and B are same, okay, if they are same, then what will be the output of XORing these two? And when A and B are different, what will be the output of this? Same, what will happen if they are same?
Sir, 0.
Okay. Sorry, wait a second. And so if the two numbers are completely same, you will get a 0. If they are having different values, okay, then it will be non-zero. So 1 XOR 1, if it is 1 XOR 1, it will be 0. Okay, similarly, any other number you have taken. Now let us look into some of the codes here. Project file does not exist. Okay. No issues. Let me check in the IAR. I'm going to close the previous codes or projects. Okay. Here in this case, I am going to close this header file right now. We'll come to the header files later. In this case, please, if possible, make note of these programs side by side. Okay. So this is my program in which I have declared a main function, and inside that we have declared a variable int a and given a value 80808080. Okay. This is 32-bit. Okay. Right now, I am not focusing more on the microcontroller, but still, if we are taking the same microcontroller in the TYC, and if we write the same values in the TYC, what will happen? So, for example, you go to the options, and you can check here, I have used the microcontroller TM4C123GH6PM, which is there in the TYC board. So, everything is same. In that case, I am using three variables, variable A, B and C. I have initialized A with 80808080, 32-bit number. Similarly, B is also the same number, 32-bit. Why 32-bit? Because it is having shifted 08080808. Now, 32-bit because each bit is represented by four bits because this is an hexadecimal number. So this number is hexadecimal. Each number or each digit is actually represented by 4 bits. So it is 32-bit, 32-bit, two variables. And C is just declared, not initialized. Okay. Now, if I say C is ORing of A and B. Okay. And then I said C is ORing of A and B. C is XORing, C is NOTing, NOT means NOT operation, and right shifted by 1, left shifted by 3 and so on. What will happen? Let's go and check these things. I will put, I'll put some breakpoints here so that I can go line by line. Right now I don't need to go put here. Okay. So now first I will go and build the project. Okay, warning, Z is not used here. Okay, so there is no such sense. Anyway, now let us run the code. So, like in the previous examples, here I have my main C window. This one is my C window. Here I have the disassembly window. Okay, and we can correlate by looking at the pointer. This is where the program counter is right now, and we can see that program counter is in the main, and here we are in the main. So what is the address? If you want to look into the address is 00000040. Okay, how can we correlate the same thing? I am repeating again. So the address we can correlate by, let us go one step ahead. Okay, look at the program counter. program counter right now is pointing at 0000044 here. Okay, program counter. And program counter is pointing to the location where the program is right now being executed. Main function. I can just go here, and rather than going through the disassembly, I can go and work with the main C program. So A is initialized to 0. Okay. Similarly, B is initialized to 0. And now you see suddenly C is not needed to be executed, because right now it is not having any variables value. So it is just declared. So it jumped to this next location, C, A or B. Now look here. In the locals, because this is a local function. Function is here. Local function is executing here. So local function is there. And inside the local function, we are declaring the C. Now C has to be A or B. Now let us check here. A is declared, B is declared, and the location of A and B are pointed here, R1 and R8. Okay, R1 is containing the value of A, and R8 is containing the variable value of B. Okay, now C is right now unavailable, because till now we have not executed the C. Till this, it is clear what is happening. If you want to change the format of this variable, okay, right now it is 251, 2155 something. Now the question is, why it is showing in this fashion? Because we actually entered the value in hexadecimal, which was looking a bit neat, 8080 8080, but here it is giving us a value, different value, because right now it is showing the value in unsigned integer type. Okay, if you want to look it into hexadecimal format, you can just right click on that variable and right click and check it into hexadecimal format. Okay, so now you can see that A and B are 8080 8080 and 0808 0808 respectively. Clear? So now, since we are actually going to do bitwise operation, it will be more easy to understand the same thing if we are looking the number in binary format. So right click and check it in the binary format. So now you see the variable is declared in 0B, declaring it as binary, and this variable is now binary. This variable is also binary. The same which was hexadecimal can be converted to binary this way. Clear? Please take note of these things which are available in the software. Now we can just go and check what is C. C is also default format. I will check it into, change it into binary. So now C is equal to A or B. It has been executed. Right now AND operation has not been executed. It is still waiting. So now if you check in the memory, the variable C is provided at register R2. Okay, R1 is A, R8 is B, and C is located at R2. And now check the variables. That means you are doing OR operation. So 0 plus 0 is 0, 0 plus 0 is 0, 0 plus 1 here. Okay, 0 plus 1 is 1. Right? Here. Similarly, wherever there is ORing taking place, you can see there is 1 appearing in that. And the result is stored in R2, which is 8888888. Clear? Similarly, you can check.
Sir, how these registers are assigned to these variables?
Is there a particular manner, or is it random? Right now, it is not random. Of course, the compiler or the IDE has its own algorithm to allocate registers. Okay, we will come to that also. If you want, we can forcefully tell which register should be holding this particular variables. Okay, right now it is managed by the IDE. Okay, and definitely the IDE will have its own algorithm how to manage the temporary registers R0 to R13, R12, so 13 registers. Okay, so in this way you can check what is the value of C during any operation, bitwise operation of ANDing, ORing, XORing and so on. Clear? Let us just check after XORing what is the value of C. So wherever the two variables are same, you can see the result is 0. Okay? And wherever there is a difference between the bits, the value will becomes ones. Wherever there is a difference between the two variables or two 0 and 1, they are two different values. In such case, you will get 1 by XORing. Similarly, you know what is bitwise NOT. Okay. Bitwise NOT means NOT of B. Just if you go through that, so it will just change the or complement the bit locations bitwise. Remember, not the number is, you are not complementing the whole number. Bitwise, you are complementing the bits. So that is why it is called bitwise operation. I am going to stop the debugging. Clear? Now let me check if there is another program which has some other details in it. Yeah. So now let us look into the program a bit more in depth. Okay. So what you are doing here is you are declaring LED red to be a number which is shifted by 1. Because if you recall, the red LED is at bit location 1, 0, 1, okay, and blue is at the location 2, and green is at the location 3. What I mean by that, I could just take a few seconds. So if you can recall, the register is 32-bit register, so 31 to 7 and 7 to 0. So 31 to 8, we can say 31 to 8 and then 7 to 0. And if you recall, 1 is not used. Okay, port F, I am saying this is the port F. This is not used. Okay, D1, D2 and D3. They are red, blue and green. Clear? So we can say if I have the 1 will be here. If I shift it by 1, it will be reaching here. So it is left shifting. If I shift the 1 by 3 times, then this 1 will become 1, 2 and 3. So I can shift the 1 to D3. So it is making my life a bit more simple. Rather recalling everything. Because sometimes what happened, for example, before we were writing 0E, 02, 04, 08 and so on. But what if suppose tomorrow I have to enable or just make the 19th bit high? Okay, in such case, or I want to make this particular bit 1. So in that case, what I will do is simply I will shift it 19 times. I will shift the 1 19 times left. Okay. So it will be much easier rather than I will first write a hexadecimal value of how to get 19th bit 1. What will be the value of hexadecimal number? It is more cumbersome or tiring. So that what I can do is I can just shift it 19 times. Okay. 19 times I can shift the 1 and I will get to this particular location. 20 times precisely because I want to go to the 19th location. So 0, then 1, 2, 3, 4, so on. Okay. Now, similarly, you can write it like this. LED red is nothing but shifting the number, that means unsigned variable 1 by 1 position. Shifting the variable 1 or bit 1 2 times will reach me, take me to the blue LED. 3 times if I shift it left, I will reach to the green LED. So these 3 variables are declared. Okay, defined. So these are my preprocessor's help. Now in place of writing 20 and all those things, I will use the red, green or blue LED. Now the question is, what is this thing here? SysCTL RCGPIO underscore R or GPIO port F DIR and all. Okay. I will come to this, don't worry. Okay, these are taken from the header file. So I will take that means in the next class I will take some time to explain you the header file. Before that, there are some concepts of C which should be known to you, or you should understand the concept very clearly before entering into the header. Of course, slowly we are moving closer to the header, but I will not discuss what are these things right now, because I will show you the header file and explain how to get into the header file in the next class. Okay. Because before that you must know structures.
Sir, are these preprocessors of the library?
No. Wait a second. Yeah. These are, I told you before getting into the header file, we must know the concept of structures. Okay. And that's why I said if we would have completed the C part, then it would have been much more easier to start or read the header file. Don't worry, I will show you what is there inside the header file. I will just, let me show you if you want. I can show you the header file, how it looks like. Okay. So this is the header file. Okay. The green means does not matter. It is all commented. These are all important things. If not defined, then define this particular thing, define this as a header file. And then even if you leave this part, okay, what are more important for us? Now, for example, you see this preprocessor we have discussed in this lecture, right? In this lecture, we have discussed about the preprocessor. See, this is the preprocessor, watchdog 0 load R. This is the preprocessor. Now you can check what is this 0x4000000. Please check what is this particular thing. What is this location? Go and check the data sheet. Anyone, what is the location of this particular register or where it is pointing to? Hello? If you check the data sheet, where that particular memory is located, 4000000, the first address of the peripheral. The peripheral starts from 4000000. I told you, the peripherals start from, or you can go to the register map and from there you can just check. Let me just go to that. Register map. Let me check. Yeah. You can check what is the location, where the hard or the 4000 that starts. Wait. Control F. 40X. So it is the address of the register for watchdog timer. Okay, in that also, I showed you these things. Wait a second. Yeah, this thing. I initially started with this window, this particular things, the memory map of TM4C123GXL. 4000 is the address of, starting address of watchdog timer 0. But watchdog timer 0, what does that mean? Then again, it has got many offset registers. There are many registers inside watchdog timer. So the complete range of address is 0FFF. 4K memory locations are allocated for timer 0. It's 4K memory has been allocated to timer 1 and so on. So now, if you check the header file, the first address is going towards watchdog timer load R register. Then watchdog timer 0 value register at 40004. Then 008 is CTL register, ICR register. Okay. So these are different register pointed there. Similarly for watchdog timer 2, that means watchdog timer 1 here. Okay. So 01. Same. Then you go to port A. You can cross check what is the starting address of port A. It is 4000. Port address, port A at port B is 5000. 4000, 5000 will be port B. port C is 4000, 6000 and so on, if you recall. Sir, inside that port A, there are so many other registers, data register, direction register, IS register, IBE, IEV, IM, RIS, MIS, AFSL. So there are so many such registers here, and here it is written or defined. Similarly, now for port B, port C and so on. And let us come down. In our lecture, we were actually talking about this thing. Wait a second. Okay. We were talking here. Wait a second. Oh, not this one. Okay. Here we were talking about what is this particular register. So this is SIST. That means this is clock gating, okay, registers. So if you go and check what is this register, if you control C, let me check in the header. If I can find control F, control V, and next, you see here, it is the RCGP GPIO's system clock, or it is just enabling that particular register. See, 400FE608 is the address, which we were writing manually. So in place of that, you can use this particular register. Similarly, next, I will come to this. Don't worry. Okay. I will come to this in the next class. Similarly, port F direction register. If I copy this and if I go and check, now the question is how to find the register in the first hand. So like I told you, these are all port F's register. In the port F register, you can see this is direction register. This is given by the address 4002-5400. Clear? So now, rather than writing the whole code, you can even write your library first in this fashion. Okay. And then you can develop your own code around the header file. So header file is nothing but it is simplifying your life. But if suppose someone else see this thing, he will be, you know, he might be thinking that these things are coming from the external world. No, these are all defined, the things. And there is nothing, no, complicated. Only thing is you must know how to write the initial program by following the steps we have discussed in the lecture. Okay. Okay. Sorry. Now, let us go to the program. So this is your RCGC GPIO register. Inside that you wrote 20U unsigned integer 20. Then you have direction register, digital enable register. You entered the values. Clear. Now, in place of 1U, or in place of writing the 1U, you can just write LED red. Okay. Here we are writing LED blue. LED blue because data register in that port F data register shift the 1 two times. If you shift the bit two times, left shift two times, you will reach to the blue LED, this one. Clear? So this is how we use the left shift or right shift operators to get to that particular bit also. This is one way to approach. Okay? So in place of that, you just first, now you are using two different things. One is using the directives or preprocessor, using that along with the bit operators, it makes your life much more simpler now. Okay, so keep these concepts of C. This is all we are discussing, embedded C, and now we are combining these two terms together, and this line makes much more beautiful meaning, like port F's, GPIO port F's, data register, make it LED blue or high. Our LED blue is shifting the bit two times left. Clear. Here you are saying data register is data register plus, or that means ORing with LED. So beforehand the LED blue will be on, and keeping the LED blue on, you can make the LED red also on. Similarly, you started the delay, the red is on, and now you initialize the counter by zero and of course reset the counter, and you made it and not of red. That means the red will be on because this was declared beforehand, and not of red. So and means multiplication with not of red means before it was one, now not of red means it becomes zero and you multiplied with the blue. Clear? So only the red LED will be blinking, keeping the blue on. Clear? Blue will be always on, and you are actually making the LED red on off, on off, on off with certain delay. Anyone having any difficulty to understand this program, please make note of this program, okay, and keep playing around these values by noting, oring, XORing and all, so that you can have more command over these operators and these things. Okay, clear? Any doubt till this part? Anyone having any doubt in this part? No. Good. Very good. Let me check what is the third program here. Okay, nothing. Okay, what is this operator? Let me come and talk about this operator.
Oring.
Or equal to. Okay, I discussed this particular types of operators when we were discussing counter equal to counter plus one. You remember this? How you read this particular code? GPIO port F. Digital enable register equal to, first read the equal to, so this register equal to this register or variable, this one. Clear? Let me just briefly tell you. So if I have something like this X, this 5, okay, you can read it like this X, then first read the equal to, then again read the X or 5. Similarly, you can write it like this X plus equal to 5. So X equal to X plus 5. Clear? Similarly, you can make more complex combinational operators, we can say. So this is how you use combinational operators in C. And you can simplify your codes a bit further. Clear? And here you are saying LED red or LED blue or LED green. That means it all these LEDs are enabled, digital enabled. All these pins are, these pins, okay, they are LED red or blue, whatever you can give the name. These pins are all output direction registers, okay. So in this way you can use, here you see, we have shifted 1 by 5 times rather than writing it 0 E or something, fifth bit we were using in the previous program. Recall what we were entering into the RCGC GPIO to make the fifth bit high. What number we were entering? 0, 0, 1. 5. So we were entering somewhere around 1000. So 10 or something. Anyone? Must be something like this. 00 and then so 0. Okay. 0 is 4 times 0. And I want to make this bit. Okay. 10 we were entering. 0x10. To make the fifth bit high. Rather than that, you can write it like this also. That means make the fifth bit high. Okay. Okay. Now, similarly, done. So this program actually allows you to directly, in single code itself, you can directly enable all these LEDs. direction and digital enabling. Okay, then the same program done. So these three programs you can use to simplify your life by combining the preprocessor and at the same time the bit operators. Clear? Now, what are the bit operators and when we use shifting, what are the things that we should keep in mind? Okay, so there are two types of shifting which can take place in the embedded world or C also. Okay, one is called logical shifting, other is called arithmetic shifting. We can shift the bits either to the left, right, left position or to the right position. Shifting bit to the left means, suppose there is a number 0001, and if I'm shifting it left, okay, left position by one bit location, then it will be 0010. Okay. And if I am shifting it right, or suppose there is a number 0010, if I shift it by right, then this number will be 0001. Okay. So this is left and right shifting. Here the symbol will be like this, and shifting right means like this. Okay. The symbol is clear. Shifting right or shifting left. Now, what is the difference between then the logical shifting and arithmetic shifting? So logical and arithmetic shifting, when you are doing left shifting, you don't have to worry. But right shifting, first let us talk about the right shifting of numbers using logical shift and arithmetic shifting. If we are using logical shifting, then we have to be very careful when we are handling the negative numbers or numbers which are in 2's complement format. Okay, negative numbers. Why? Because here you can see this number 1101 is minus 3. 1 is representing the negative sign and this number is your magnitude. We know that. Okay, we have studied this thing, magnitude and sign. This is minus 3 in 2's complement, remember. Okay, someone might say, sir, ye to 5 hai. No, it is not 5, it is minus 3, 2's complement. Now if you rotate it right, okay, using logical shifting, then a zero is entered in the MSB part. It is introduced with a zero. So now this number suddenly becomes a positive number, and now you can read, because positive, so you don't have to take a 2's complement. Directly if you read, it becomes 6. So there is no sense in that. Okay, remember one short thing, that if you are using logical shift, then zero is introduced. Okay, in the MSB, sorry, MSB, okay. In the MSB, you get zero using Little Endian system. If you can correlate Little Endian and, okay, system to this part. Now, in arithmetic shifting, when we do arithmetic right shift, one is entered into the MSB or Little Endian, okay. So, if you see here, minus 3, and if you shift it right, now zero is introduced here when you are shifting towards right. Okay, in place of zero, in arithmetic shifting, one is introduced. So it becomes, now again you have to take 2's complement of 110 and you will get 2, minus 2. Clear? So just simply recalling, remember this, when you are logical shifting, MSB is getting zero, and if you are arithmetic shifting, the MSB is getting 1. Okay. Similarly, logical shifting left, in case of arithmetic and logical logical shifting, both are same. Whether you logical shift left or right, logical arithmetic shift left, both are same. Or you can just remember this part. Logical shifting left and arithmetic shifting left are both equal in both cases. Okay, so there is no complication in that. So let us see how we can shift left. When we are introducing zero, so here 1101 is there. So if I shift it towards left, then it becomes 1010. Here zero is introduced in the LSB part. Okay, similarly, if I make it 1101, the same number, and if I shift towards left, again a zero is introduced at the LSB part. So we have to keep in mind that when we are doing a logical or arithmetic shifting, whether we are using right or left. If you are using left, don't worry about anything. But if you are using right, then you have to be very careful. Anyway, most of the time you don't have to come across this thing. But here, why I was talking about this part, because in the disassembly, you see the IDE automatically decides whether he should go for arithmetic shifting right or logical shifting right. Don't worry, you don't have to worry about that part, but the IDE understands that part, that whether I should opt for logical shifting or arithmetic shifting, and appropriately he will use his own functions. Okay, these are all optimized. Okay, clear?